Hey there, fellow game devs, and welcome back to Soul's Game Dev Journey. In our previous episode, we've started to set up interactions with our world. We've set up the input actions, defining panning, zooming, and focus. In spite of all of that, the only thing we really got to show for it was a moving camera target. Today, we will get to finally link it up to Cinemachine to be able to move around the world. At the end, we will have a top-down camera which you can pan around and zoom, as well as an orbital camera that will focus on the camera target, like you can see on the screen. The key thing still missing is to be able to select or focus a tile, but we will do this in the future. All of this will be done with Cinemachine, so let's talk about it first. Cinemachine is essentially a suite of tools and components designed to make camera management in Unity as intuitive and flexible as possible. It's like having a professional camera crew built right into your game engine. Now, let's talk about its main parts. 1. Cinemachine Brain. This is the director of our camera show. The Cinemachine Brain manages and orchestrates all the Cinemachine components and virtual cameras in your scene. It decides which camera to use at any given moment, making sure your game looks its best. 2. Cinemachine Virtual Cameras. Think of these as your virtual camera operators. You can have multiple virtual cameras in your scene, each with its own settings and behaviors. Virtual cameras can follow targets, blend between shots, and even create stunning cinematic sequences. There are many parts to the virtual camera that define its behavior, look, and interactions. The Cinemachine system could require a whole series dedicated to it, and I'm sure you can find it both in Unity resources as well as other YouTube channels. But because it's such a humongous system, it may feel intimidating to even start with it. Our implementation is going to be fairly straightforward as we're not making cutscenes, dialogue scenes, or anything like that. But it should be enough to familiarize ourselves with the system, and when we're more comfortable using it, we can start complicating things further. So, how can we achieve what we want with as little as possible? We'll need to start by installing the Cinemachine system. And first, when we're access more package manager. It, we can start in Unity's main menu. Further. Navigate so, to the window option at the top. Want with as little as from possible. The drop-down menu, we'll need to start select by package installing manager. The Cinemachine. This will open the package manager package window. Manager. Then we need Unity's to find and install Cinemachine. To the window in the package the manager window, you'll see a list of available packages. Package there's a search bar at the top the right. Package make sure you're window. Browsing Unity registry, then not your project. Then we need to find and install Cinemachine. In the search in bar, the package type Cinemachine and press you'll enter. See a list of available you should packages. Now see the Cinemachine package in the list of packages. Make sure click on the install button next to the Cinemachine package. In the Unity bar, will now download and install the Cinemachine package. You'll see a progress bar indicating the installation status. And to click on verify everything went well, check in the list of packages. Confirm Unity that Cinemachine is listed as the Cinemachine. Now we can start preparing the scene. We already have two components we will be using. Those are our main camera and camera target. I want to keep all of this organized, so I will create a new empty object, reset its transform, and name it Camera System. Now drag and drop the main camera and camera target and attach them to the camera system object in the hierarchy. Now we will start adding the Cinemachine parts. Let's start by adding the Cinemachine Brain component. With the main camera game object selected, go to the inspector window. Click on the Add Component button to open the component search field. In the search field, type Cinemachine Brain and press Enter. You should now see Cinemachine Brain in the search results. Click on Cinemachine Brain to add it as a component to your main camera. Let's talk about what we have here. The Cinemachine Brain component is an essential part of the Cinemachine package in Unity. It serves as the manager for your Cinemachine virtual cameras, controlling which camera is active and handling transitions between cameras seamlessly. Let's have a quick overview of what it is responsible for. Cinemachine Brain manages the activation and deactivation of Cinemachine virtual cameras based on specific conditions you define. This allows you to smoothly switch between different camera perspectives or modes during gameplay. It also handles the blending of multiple virtual cameras, enabling smooth transitions and crossfades between them. This is especially useful for creating cinematic effects. Cinemachine Brain uses a priority system to determine which virtual camera should take control. The camera with the highest priority becomes the active camera. It supports both instant cuts between cameras and gradual blends. This flexibility ensures that your camera changes are visually appealing and player-friendly. After adding Cinemachine Brain, you'll typically work with other components like Cinemachine Virtual Cameras to define camera behaviors and shots. Cinemachine Brain ties everything together, making your camera system coherent and responsive. So let's do this now. Let's create a new empty object in the hierarchy and add the Cinemachine Virtual Camera component to it. First, we'll make the top-down camera, so let's name it appropriately. When the specific virtual camera is active, it's not just the camera angle that changes, like if we put a few ordinary Unity cameras in the scene. I'll focus on the most important setting for what I want to achieve. The follow and look at fields will both receive the camera target as their reference. The lens property has two important settings for us, the FOV, which we will adjust in the code, and the far clipping plane, which you may need to adjust if you set your camera too far away, so that objects from the scene won't get clipped. The body controls translation, and every option from the drop-down will have their own settings. I want to minimize visual clutter, so I will select the transposer option. The binding mode I'll set to simple follow with world up and set the Y component of offset to 300. This means that the camera will actually be targeting a point 300 units above the camera target. This probably isn't the technically correct way of doing things. I should probably keep this at 0 and add a camera offset extension, but since in this case the result is the same, I'll keep it simple. We will set the aim to hard look at to make the camera face our camera target. If we play now, everything should almost work, except the camera rotates 180 when we move down, which is not what I want at all. If you set the damping to 0, it will stop doing that, however it will also not tilt in the direction of movement, but I'm okay with that. The top-down camera should now pan around the way we want to. We will get to the zooming when we update the code. Now let's add the focus camera. I want the camera to be close to the tile and rotate around the center in a steady orbit. First things first. We need to create another empty game object and add the Cinemachine virtual camera to it. The follow and look at fields will again be set to the camera target object, but this time we will choose the orbital transposer option for the body instead of a regular transposer as before. There are many more options here. The most important one will be the follow offset. I want to be a bit up and behind from the center. My hex has a radius of 30, so I will put the camera 40 behind. As for the up, I think 20 gives a nice angle for now. I'll again remove all damping by setting it to 0. We will set the heading to target forward, making our default position looking from the back to the front of the camera target. In our case, this essentially means looking from the bottom of the map to the top of the map. By default, the orbit takes the mouse x-axis as a way to control the orbiting. If you like that, you can keep it, but I want to orbit with time. This means the recenter to target heading should be disabled. Acceleration time and deceleration time will be set to 0. Input axis name will be set to an empty string. Perhaps not necessary, but I'll also set the input axis value to 0. We will use the speed variable in the code, so you can use this to determine the speed of orbit later. Lastly, we need to set the aim to hard look at so that we're fixated on the center of orbit. There we go. We've successfully set things up at the editor, and the panning already works. The only things left to do are to orbit through time and to expand our camera controller script to allow for switching the cameras and setting them up. Let's start by first completing the focus camera. As always, let's start by creating a C# script. I'll call it orbit camera with time. We'll need a reference to the virtual camera as well as to the orbital transposer. On top of that, I'll add a rotation speed field, which we will set from the orbital transposer's max speed. This is so that we have as few potentially conflicting or confusing parameters on the object. We'll be using coroutines to rotate, similarly to what we've done with the panning and camera controller in the last video. In the awake method, we will get the references to the virtual camera and orbital transposer. This one is a little bit different, as we need to use a getCinemachine component rather than the typical getComponent method. We will then get the reference to the rotation speed from the transposer's x-axis, max speed. We'll also subscribe to an event from camera controller called onCameraChanged, which we will put in shortly. In this method, we'll have the same structure as in the pan method, which starts and stops rotation coroutine accordingly. And the coroutine itself is very simple. Simply add the rotation speed multiplied by the delta time to the transposer's x-axis value. Everything else is handled within the transposer natively, such as min and max angle, wrap, invert, etc. That's all there is to it. The limitation here is that the rotation speed won't get updated when changed on the transposer. If you want that functionality, you should add the following code to the script. This code will keep checking if the rotation speed has been updated during play mode. This way you can now change the max speed on the orbit camera transposer, and when the value is changed, it will pass that change to our script, updating the speed. This allows you to more quickly and easily find the orbit speed you want. If we now set priority of the focus camera higher than the top-down camera, or simply disable it for testing, we can see that the camera will move not with the movement of the mouse, but will instead steadily rotate around the camera target position. With this, the focus camera is working just as I want it to. The only issue right now is the positioning, but this will be fixed once we can interact with hexes and can snap the camera target to a selected hex. Now, we can get the top-down camera to work the way we want to as well. We have this set up in the Camera Controller class, though one could easily argue it should be separated out. For now, let's just get it to work. The camera has already been moving since the last video, so now we only need to get the zoom walk ring. There are two important properties for a perspective camera that will determine how much of the world the camera sees: distance to the objects we're observing and the field of view. The closer the object is and the narrower the field of view, the more zoomed in the object will be. There's more to this though. The further away you put the camera, the more distant your clipping plane will need to be, and the more extreme the field of view, the more distortion you will notice. This is completely up for the aesthetics and personal preference, but you're probably looking to set your distance such that your typical intended usage will keep the field of view between 50 and 100. Or set the field of view the way you want and zoom by moving the camera up or down. In this implementation, I'm going for zooming with field of view, and for this I will add the following parameters to the camera controller: camera zoom speed, camera zoom min for the narrowest field of view, camera zoom max for the widest field of view, and camera zoom default for the default field of view. I will also add a zoom coroutine and on camera changed action for the orbit camera to subscribe to. Let's add a camera mode and to help us easily switch between cameras. For now, we will have the top-down option and focus option. To add F option for a default setting, let's create a default mode field. And to keep track of current selection, we can add current mode field. I'll also use the same priority for all cameras, so I'll just keep track of that in a constant as well. Now let's look at the methods. Firstly, on zoom changed works pretty much the same way as the on pan changed. So much so that we can just copy it and rename the variable names. The biggest difference is simply that we're not changing the camera when we're zooming. Instead, we change that in the onFocus change where, if we've performed the focus action by double-tapping the F key, we want to, for now, just change the camera to focus mode. For the actual functionality of zooming, we have the process zoom coroutine. It's again very similar to the process pan, but this time we're reading a float value rather than a vector 2. And we also clamp the values between min and max. This is something we should also add at some point for the panning to prevent the player to go outside of the range of the grid. If we set the priority on the top-down camera higher than the zoom camera, we should now be able to test zooming in the editor. You may need to implement an empty change camera method for now. Once you have it working, you can adjust the min and max values as well as the default any way you want to achieve the desired look. Now for the final part, changing the camera. We need a change camera method which will take the camera mode parameter. We will change the current mode to the desired mode to keep track of it. Then we will implement a helper method, which will return the correct camera based on the mode. Then we will invoke the on-camera changed event with the camera property, and set the camera priority to default priority. This bit is done just in case so that we always have all cameras at the same priority. So how can we change them then? With an already provided method, move to top of priority subqueue. This method does just that, it puts the given camera at the top of priority queue of all cameras that have the same priority. Finally, in the start method, we will set the default zoom level to the field of view of the top-down camera lens and change camera to the default camera. Now we can test this part in the editor as well. When we play the game, we should get the top-down view. We should be able to move around and zoom. On a double tap of the F key, the camera should change to the orbital camera. And if we start moving again, we should go back to the top-down view. A lot has been covered so far and a lot more is to come in this series. Since there's many places one can get lost, I will publish the current state of the game on GitHub, where you can download it and check what you may be missing. You can also ask questions on the Discord server. Link to both is in the description below. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you like the series.